thermodynamic instability in the atmosphere, right? In the last class, we discussed about the static stability and the partial method, right? We also discussed about the level of free convection, cape, CINE, etc., right? So what is the full form of CINE? Can anyone say? Full form of CINE?
So convective inhibition energy.
Inhibition energy, right, that's right. So, and we have seen also different profiles of the atmosphere on the Tiffy gram, how, you know, different profiles are favorable or unfavorable for the development of the clouds, especially the convective clouds, right? Generally on the Tiffy gram, we try to analyze the convective clouds, right? Not the non-convective clouds, because the formation of the non-convective cloud, the mechanism of formation of non-convective clouds like stratiform clouds are different than the convective clouds. And generally we use the Tiffy gram for the analysis of the convective clouds, because we try to analyze the cape, the convective available potential energy, and so on, right? Today, we shall try to discuss, am I visible, is my photo, live photo visible or?
Yes, that's visible.
Okay,
yes,
okay.
Sir.
So today we shall discuss about the upward acceleration of an air parcel, okay? Suppose if a cloud, convective cloud has formed, okay? And there is a instability in the atmosphere, right? And there is a instability in the atmosphere. And we discussed that atmosphere will be unstable when gamma, the lapse rate of the atmosphere, is greater than the dry adiabatic lapse rate. Do you remember that? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and we also discussed about the cape. Last time we discussed about the cape, convective available potential energy, right? So, if there is a cape present in the atmosphere, the parcel of air, okay, let's say this is the ground, will accelerate by itself, go to the higher levels, right? Become deeper and deeper, isn't it? So, what will be the acceleration of this parcel? What will be the acceleration of this parcel? Right? Acceleration, as you know, is d square z divided by dt square. Right? This is the acceleration, isn't it? When we say this dz divided by dt, what is this? What is this dz divided by dt? Tell me.
So velocity of the parcel?
Yes, velocity of the parcel in the vertical, right? That is the vertical velocity, isn't it?
Yes,
that is the vertical velocity, generally denoted by W, right? In the z coordinate system. That is the z coordinate system, Cartesian coordinate system, right? When we talk about the isobaric coordinate system, instead of z, if there is a p pressure as a vertical coordinate, then the same thing we indicate as omega. Omega is equal to dp divided by dt. This is also vertical velocity, but in the isobaric coordinate system. and this is the vertical velocity in the Cartesian coordinate system, Z coordinate system, right? So now if you want to find out what is the acceleration of this air parcel or the cloud if the atmosphere is unstable, that is when there is a cape present in the atmosphere, or when the gamma is greater than gamma d, what will be the acceleration of the air parcel or the cloud air? Okay, that's what we are going to find out now, discuss now, right? So now coming back to the PPT, let's consider a box of an air parcel of unit volume with its center of mass at a height z above the Earth's surface. Okay, like this, as indicated in this diagram. Let us see that. Let's say that this box is representing an air parcel or cloud parcel. Okay, let's say that the density and temperature of this cloud air or cloud parcel is rho prime and T prime. Rho prime and T prime are the density and temperature of this cloud parcel. Okay, whereas rho and T are the density and T temperature of the surrounding environment. Okay, let's say that the height of the cloud parcel is z. The cloud parcel is at a height z from the surface. Okay, so there will be upward force acting on the parcel and there will be downward force acting on the parcel, right? Indicated by these thick arrows. These thick arrows are indicating the upward and downward forces acting on this cloud air mass or cloud parcel. Okay, so that's what we have said. Let the density and the temperature of the air parcel be rho prime T prime, and the density and temperature of the ambient air are rho and T. So the vertical forces acting on the air parcel are indicated by these arrows. All right. Now, if we consider a unit volume of the air mass or air parcel, its mass will be simply rho prime because we are considering volume to be unit, right? Volume is unit. So the mass of the air parcel will be simply rho prime, isn't it? Now, therefore, the downward force acting on a unit volume of the air parcel is rho prime times g, right? The downward force will be rho prime g. You know, from the second law of Newton's second law of motion. What is Newton's second law of motion?
F
is equal to ma.
Yes, exactly. Force is equal to mass into acceleration, isn't it? Yeah, force is equal to mass into acceleration. So the downward force acting on this unit volume of air will be rho prime g, where g is the acceleration due to gravity. Okay, now from the Archimedes principle, the upward force acting on the air parcel is equal in magnitude to the gravitational force that acts on the ambient air that is displaced by the air parcel. Because as the air parcel is rising upwards, it will displace an air mass. The ambient air mass will be displaced, right? So according to our Archimedes principle, right, if you have studied that in your basic science book, the upward force acting on the air parcel will be equal to in magnitude to the gravitational force that acts on the ambient air that is displaced by the air parcel, right? So because a unit volume of ambient air of density rho is displaced by the air parcel, the magnitude of the upward force acting on the air parcel will be rho g, right? So rho g is the magnitude of the upward force on the air parcel, right? Rho g is the upward force on the air parcel, whereas rho prime g is the downward force, right? This is the downward force, this is the upward force. Okay, therefore the net upward force acting on a unit volume of air parcel F will be equal to simply rho minus rho prime times g. This is the net force, right? This is the upward force acting on the parcel, the downward force on the acting on the parcel, and so the net force will be rho minus rho prime times g, right? Because the mass of unit volume of air parcel is rho prime, because it is unit volume, the upward acceleration of the parcel is b square by z by dt square equal to f divided by rho, right? F divided by rho. And this is equal to rho minus rho prime divided by rho prime times g, right? So this is the acceleration of the air parcel. Okay, this will be the acceleration of the air parcel, where z is the height of the air parcel, right? This is the z, height of the air parcel. So from the gas equation, as you know, the gas equation is P equal to rho RT, that is the equation of a state, right? Equation of a state of the ideal gas. The densities of the air parcel and the ambient air are inversely proportional to the temperature. From this ideal gas law, the density is inversely proportional to temperature, and hence you can write the last equation as d square z by dt square is equal to 1 by t minus 1 by t prime divided by 1 by t times gravity, acceleration due to gravity, right? Or we can write d prime z by dt square, just rearranging this, is equal to g times t prime minus t divided by t, right? This will be the acceleration of the air parcel. Now remember, t prime is the temperature of the cloud air, cloud parcel, right? T is the temperature of the surrounding air or ambient air, right? So in other words, the density of the cloud parcel is proportional to the difference in the temperature between the cloud and the surrounding air, isn't it? That means how warm, how much warm is the cloud compared to the surrounding air will dictate the acceleration of that air parcel. Okay, will provide the acceleration of the air parcels, right? Depends upon how much the cloud parcel is warmer compared to the surrounding air. Strictly speaking, virtual temperature, actually instead of T, we should have considered TB, right, in place of T in all expressions relating to the static stability. However, the virtual temperature correction is usually neglected except in some certain calculations relating to the boundary layer. So even if we consider T instead of TB, the magnitude will be almost the same, right? So this was a very important calculation of the density of the acceleration of the air parcel. How will be the, how much will be the acceleration of the air parcel if we, if the parcel of air is in a convective environment, or if there is a convection present in the atmosphere, or if the KB is positive, right? So this is basically proportional, you can say, even proportional to the T prime minus T divided by T, okay? And this is nothing but the difference of the temperature of the air parcel. This is T prime and this is T, right? So how much warm is this cloud compared to the surrounding air will tell us the acceleration of this air parcel. How much will be the acceleration of this air parcel? Okay. So now let us discuss another very important parameter called the Brunt-Baisala frequency. Brunt-Baisala frequency. This is another important parameter generally used to indicate the atmospheric instability. The Brunt-Baisala frequency is generally used to indicate the atmospheric instability. Okay. Now let's consider this thermodynamic diagram once again that you had seen earlier. Okay. In which there were height versus temperature. Okay. Height in the y-axis, temperature in the x-axis. All right. And let us say this is the lapse rate of the environment, gamma. Okay. And this is the dry adiabatic lapse rate, gamma d. Okay. Now let's say this is a reference level, z is equal to z zero or z naught. Okay. Now let's say the parcel of air is raised from this level to another level, say here. Okay. Now at this level, because initially the parcel will be unsaturated, so it will lose the temperature at the rate of dry adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. Whereas the environmental lapse rate is this one, gamma B. So the this will be the temperature, TA will be the temperature of the air parcel, and TB will be the temperature of the surrounding air, right? T will be the temperature of the surrounding air, right? Now keep this in mind, okay? So let's Z is equal to Z zero, zero be the equilibrium level of the air parcel. Let's discuss that. Let the air parcel is displaced upward, okay? Displaced upward from its equilibrium level, Z is equal to zero, by a distance Z prime, okay? Let's say Z prime, to a new level where the ambient temperature is T. At this level, the temperature is T, okay? The air parcel is then released, okay? So the vertical displacement of the air parcel from its equilibrium level, of this level, is Z prime equal to Z minus Z prime, okay? This is the displacement. This is the displacement because it is raised or displaced from here to there, okay? So the displacement will be Z minus Z prime. Now let T0 be the environmental temperature at Z is equal to Z0. Let the temperature of the environment here is T0. So if the air parcel is lifted dry adiabatically through a distance Z from its equilibrium level, its temperature will become T prime is equal to T0 minus gamma D times Z, because gamma D is the dry adiabatic lapse rate, right? So the because the parcel will lose its temperature at the rate of dry adiabatic lapse rate. So the temperature of the parcel T prime at this level, that is TA, will be equal to this one, T0, okay, temperature at this level, minus gamma D times Z prime. And therefore, T prime minus T, we can, from this, you know, we can also, similarly, we can also write what, like another expression for T, is equal to T0 minus gamma times Z prime. So T minus T prime minus T will become equal to minus of gamma D minus gamma times Z prime. Okay. So in other words, you can calculate the warmer, how much warmer is the air parcel based upon the lapse rate and the height Z. Substituting this last expression into this expression, this expression, right? This is the acceleration of the air parcel. So substituting this expression into this expression, okay, we can get d squared z prime by dt squared equal to minus gt times gamma d minus gamma times z prime, okay? So this is the acceleration of the air parcel in terms of the lapse rate. Acceleration of the air parcel in terms of the lapse rate, which may be written in the form d prime z by dt square plus n square times z prime, where n square is representing this entire term. Okay, so just writing this expression in this form, where n square is given by this entire term, where n is equal to T by T gamma D minus gamma square root of that, because N square is this one, so square root of that, okay? This N is referred to as the Brunt-Weissala frequency, okay? This N is called the Brunt-Weissala frequency. And as you can see that, because this is related to the acceleration of the air parcel, right? This is related to the lapse rate of the environment related to the dry adiabatic lapse rate. And therefore, N or the brunt Vaisala frequency is also used as a measure of the instability. It's another way to measure the instability in the atmosphere. Okay, so this equation 32, it is second order ordinary differential equation, right? This is second order ordinary differential equation. If the layer in the question is stably stratified, that is to say, if gamma d is more than gamma, right? Gamma d is more than gamma, then we can be assured that n is real and n square is positive, right? If gamma d is more than gamma, then this will be positive, right? And n will be real, right? N will be real. And the solution of the equation 32 in that case will be z prime equal to a cos nt plus b sin nt, right? When gamma d is positive, n will be positive, and the solution of this equation can be, this is the differential equation, right? Ordinary differential equation. It will be z prime equal to a cos nt plus b sin nt. You have studied the differential equation, right, in your BSc, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good. So, making use of the conditions at the point of maximum displacement at time t equal to 0, namely that z prime is equal to z prime at 0 and dz prime by dt is equal to 0 at time t equal to 0, it follows that z prime at time t is equal to z prime at 0 times cos of nt. Okay. Cos of nt, right? Because the sine of nt will be 0. That is to say, the parcel executes a buoyancy oscillation about its equilibrium level z with amplitude equal to its initial displacement z prime, 0, and the frequency n in units of radians per second. Okay. So basically, in that case, the parcel will be oscillating up and down. Okay. It is pushed up, it will go up. If it is pushed down, it will go down because it is unstable. So the Brunt Vaisala frequency is thus a measure of the static stability. The higher the frequency, the greater the ambient stability. Right? Higher the frequency, the greater the ambient stability. So air parcels undergo buoyancy oscillations in association with gravity waves. Gravity waves, the widespread phenomena in planetary atmosphere. Okay, as illustrated in the figure in the next slide. Gravity waves. Have you seen the gravity waves physically? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Where did you see the gravity wave?
Sir, sea beach.
Where?
Sir, in a beach.
Yeah, in a beach also there is a sort of gravity wave. Yeah. For simple gravity waves, you can generate yourself. You just throw a stone in a pond, right? Then ripples will be generated, right? The waves are generated, isn't it? And those waves are basically the gravity waves, right? And the waves will propagate outward from the point where we have thrown the stone in the water, in the calm water. The waves will get generated and it will propagate outward. So basically, they are the gravity waves. Similar gravity waves are also generated in the atmosphere. In the atmosphere also, similar gravity waves are generated. Like when thermal is popping out because of the, suppose, say, you've got a heating, this is the ground, okay, and ground is strongly heated by the radiation, so convection will start, thermals will start rising up, okay, thermals will start rising up, and at a certain point, clouds will form, right? And because of this, it will introduce or it will generate the gravity waves in the atmosphere. As you have thrown a stone in the pond, gravity waves got generated. Similarly, this rising of this air bubble will generate the gravity waves. Right? Also, in the mountain areas, in the hilly regions, in the mountains, suppose. Okay, let us say this is a mountain. Okay, this is a mountainous area. And you've got a wind flowing like this. This is your wind. Okay, so it will go along the topography, right? The winds will go along topography, isn't it? The wind is blowing like this. It will go like this, right? So you get waves formed in the leeward side of the mountain. Okay, this is the leeward side. Side of the mountain. This is the windward side, isn't it? This is called the windward side. Windward side, right? So on the leeward side of the mountains, the waves get generated. Okay. This kind of vortices, circulations get generated. Lee waves, also they are called the lee waves. Okay. So these are some kind of a gravity waves. These are some kind of and if there is sufficient moisture in the air, right? If the air is moist, then clouds will form, isn't it? And you can see these clouds like a series of waves in the mountain areas. Have you seen such clouds in the mountain areas? I'll show you some diagram. Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sometimes it forms lenticular clouds like.
Yeah, lenticular also clouds form in the mountain area. That is also basically a manifestation of the presence of waves in the mountain. Okay. The lenticular clouds are also a manifestation of the presence of waves in the atmosphere. Lenticular cloud. You have rightly said that is a lenticular cloud. You have seen the photo of a lenticular cloud.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. It looks like a shape of a lens. You have studied lens, right? In your physics, optics, mysteries. So the clouds look like this one because it is along the wave. It is along the wave. Okay. Lenticular cloud, right? You can see nice diagrams in the Google image. You can find out many beautiful photos of the lenticular cloud. Okay. So, all right. So let's go to the next slide. So gravity waves may be excited by the flow of our mountain near terrain, as shown in the photograph, or by an intense local disturbance. Okay. Now this image taken from the satellite, it can be also taken from a ground-based station, shows these interesting clouds. Can you see this wave structure in the cloud here? Wavy pattern? This wavy pattern? Is this diagram visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So these wavy pattern in the clouds are basically indicating that there is a presence of the gravity wave in the atmosphere, right? This kind of pattern in the cloud is indicating that there is a existence or presence of the gravity waves in the atmosphere. Must be somewhere near the mountain area. Okay. So We have discussed the atmospheric instability in terms of the Brunt Vaisala frequency, right? Brunt Vaisala frequency. And we also discuss how to calculate or compute the acceleration of an air particle which is rising up in an unstable atmosphere, right? Now, the instability of the atmosphere, as we have seen earlier, can be expressed or can be determined based upon the lapse rate, isn't it? Lapse rate of the atmosphere relative to the dry adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. The instability can be also expressed in terms of the Brunt Vaisala frequency. And also the lapse instability can be expressed in terms of the potential temperature. The instability can also be expressed in terms of the potential temperature. And we shall see how. Okay. So using the ideal gas law and the hydrostatic equation, that is, this is the ideal gas law, isn't it? And this is the hydrostatic equation d dz is equal to minus alpha, where alpha is the specific volume dp. Or you can say simply, no, dp is equal to rho g dz, right? Dp is equal to, because alpha is 1 by rho. So dp is equal to rho g dz. So this is the equation of the state of the ideal gas, and this is the hydrostatic equation. So using these two equations and taking the log of the Poisson's equation, that is the equation for the potential temperature, right? Taking the log of the potential temperature equation, and then after that differentiating it, we can write Cp times d theta by theta is equal to Cp times dT by T minus R and dP by P, right? Where R is the gas constant, universal gas constant, Cp is the specific heat at the constant pressure, theta is the potential temperature. I told you last time that this is the standard notation for potential temperature is theta, right? And this we got how? From the Poisson's equation. We just took the logarithm of the Poisson equation and then we differentiated it. So we got this one, right? So combining the above three equations, that is the equation of the state, the hydrostatic equation, and the potential temperature equation in this form, we can get Cp T d theta by theta equal to Cp dt plus g dz, right? Combining these three equations, we can write this equation. Now, letting d theta is equal to del theta by del z times dz, and dt equal to del t by del z times dz, and dividing through by Cp dz in this equation, we can get 1 by theta by del z equal to 1 by t times del t by del z plus g by Cp, right? Using this fact and dividing this equation both sides by Cp dz, we can get this equation 1 by theta by del z is equal to 1 by t del t by del z plus g by Cp. Okay. Let's say this is equation number 34. So, this is the equation 1 by theta by del z is equal to 1 by t del t by del z plus g by Cp. Now, if you remember, g by Cp is the dry adiabatic lapse rate, right? Lapse rate of the dry adiabatic, right? So, and del t by del z actually is the actual lapse rate, gamma, right? The actual lapse rate of the environment or surrounding air or atmosphere is gamma, which is dt by dz, right? And the dry adiabatic lapse rate is gamma, g by Cp. So, we can write this equation 34 as 1 by theta by del z is equal to 1 by t times gamma d minus gamma. Right, gamma is this one and gamma d is this one. This is 35. However, it has been shown earlier that when gamma is less than gamma d, the air is characterized by positive static stability. When the lapse rate of the environment is less than the dry adiabatic lapse rate, then it will be a stable situation, right? Hence, we can write these statements like if del theta by del z is greater than zero, then it is a stable situation. Atmosphere is stable. When del theta by del z is greater than zero, no, it should be equal, not greater. It should be equal, right? Then it is a neutral condition. And when del theta by del z is less than zero, then it is an unstable situation, right? It's an unstable situation. So that means we can express the atmospheric instability also in terms of the rate of change of potential temperature with height. We can express the atmospheric instability in terms of the potential temperature, rate of change of potential temperature with height. So now you have learned how the atmospheric instability or thermodynamic instability can be expressed in terms of the lapse rate, in terms of the Brent-Waisala frequency, as well as in terms of the rate of change of potential temperature with height. Actually, this is one of the very common form to express the atmospheric instability, right? So now, looking back at the T5 gram, okay, the T5 gram, as we said earlier, that you know, it is very useful and it will come up at many places in the atmospheric physics. Now let's consider this diagram. Okay, as usual, on the x-axis we have z kilometer, and the y-axis, it is the y-axis, and on the x-axis we have got the temperature, right? So let us see, let's say that this is the temperature of the atmosphere, temperature profile of the atmosphere as measured by the radiosonde, right? So let's say at the starting point, let us say at the ground, this is at the surface, this is the temperature, and this is the dew point temperature. Okay, dew point temperature approximately 15 degree, and the dry wall temperature approximately, ambient air temperature approximately 30 degree. So when this air parcel is lifted upward, because it is unsaturated, it may be unsaturated in the beginning, so it will follow the dry adiabatic lapse rate, and this will be the mixing ratio line. So the two will meet each other, right, and get saturated here. So the cloud base will form here, clouds will start form here, this is the cloud base. And this area, as you have discussed last time, is the CINE, convective inhibition energy. Still the parcel will not be buoyant because its temperature is still lower than the surrounding air. But from this point onwards, because it has become saturated now, so it will lose the temperature at the rate of saturated adiabatic lapse rate or pseudo-adiabatic lapse rate. So it will go on like this one. So this point, at this point, the two lines will intersect each other. So this will be the level of free convection. And after that, the parcel or cloud parcel will become buoyant automatically. It will start ascending automatically, rising up, of course, automatically. So this will be the, will form the clouds, right? Eventually, at this point, again, the two lines cross each other. So this will be the top of the cloud. So this is the top of the cloud, this is the base of the cloud, and this is the depth of the cloud. Right? This is the depth of the cloud. Okay. And you have seen this diagram earlier also, right? This is the T5 gram. Now, the original T5 gram, and which, you know, this is again the temperature profile of the environment as measured by the radiosonde. And this is the, this light curve, I don't know whether it is visible to you or not. This light curve is the dew point temperature. Is this curve visible to you? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
This curve is visible?
Yes.
Okay, good. So this is the dew point temperature profile of the atmosphere. And this is the air temperature.
Yes,
is the air temperature, okay? And as we discussed earlier, initially when the parcel of air is raised upward, okay, this will follow the dry adiabatic lapse rate, okay, and this will follow the saturation mixing ratio line, okay, the two will meet each other. and then become saturated. This will be the CCL integrated, and the convective condensation level, because this is the crossing point of the two lines. And from there onwards, the air parcel will become buoyant and follow the moisture debate. So this area, this shaded area, the pink shaded area, is the cape convective available potential energy, right? Is the convective available potential energy. And so this energy is actually hidden in the atmosphere. This energy cape is the hidden energy in the atmosphere, but it will be released only when the parcel is able to come up to this level. If the parcel cannot reach up to this level, then this hidden energy will be of no use to this parcel of air, because it will not be able to rise by itself. Until it reaches this level, it will not be able to rise by itself, right? Get the point? So this is the kind which is inhibiting the ascent of the parcel, and this kind has to be broken. This convective inhibition energy has to be broken. That means the parcel has to be forcefully lifted by some means, mechanically lifted by flow along a topography, or lifted upward because of the convection currents. Then only it will be able to reach up to this level. And after that, the hidden energy which is there in the atmosphere will be realized, will help it grow automatically upward, right? So this is the implications of the presence of stability in the atmosphere, right? Okay. So generally, it is written here that the modification of morning sounding for afternoon surface heating. Morning, because the temperature is less, right? So generally, atmosphere tends to be stable. But as the day progresses, the solar radiation hits the Earth more and more. Atmosphere gets heated more and more, right? So the atmosphere tends to become more and more unstable as the day progresses, right? And that is natural. Also in the winter season, you may know that morning times we have got fog, right? But the fog is broken as the day progresses because of the solar heating of the dawn, right? So as the heating takes place, generally, as I had said earlier, in the winter season we have got inversion, lower level inversion, and that inversion in the temperature or inversion in that air prevents the rising of the fog, right? Or mixing of the lower layer air mass with the upper layer air mass. But as the day progresses, heating increases, inversion is broken, and the lower air mass or air mass in the lower levels get chance to rise up or mix up with the air mass of the upper level, and the fog gets dissipated, right? Fog gets dissipated. So this is about the stability analysis of unsaturated air. So far, so we have been discussing about the stability analysis of the unsaturated air. But what about the saturated air? If the air is saturated, how will we determine the stability in the atmosphere, right? Because when the air is saturated, its lapse rate will be different, isn't it? When the air is saturated, the lapse rate will be different, isn't it? So, in that case, the stability will be different, right? Stability will be different. And in that situation, we get a concept of the so-called conditional instability. Conditional instability. And we shall discuss that in detail, maybe now today is already 1:32. So we shall discuss that in detail in the next class. what the conditional instability, right? And conditional instability occurs when the lapse rate of the environment is less than the saturated adiabatic lapse rate, which is less than the dry adiabatic lapse rate. Gamma less than gamma S is less than gamma D. Okay. So that is a conditional instability. We shall discuss that in detail next time. Okay. Rather, it should be like this one. Gamma lies between conditional instability. When the lapse rate of the air is less than gamma D and gamma S is less than gamma. That means lapse rate of the environment lies between gamma S and gamma D. That is normally the case also, because this is approximately 6 to 7 degrees, you can say 6 to 7 degree Kelvin per kilometer. This is approximately 10 Kelvin per kilometer, and this is approximately 4 Kelvin per kilometer. So this is less than gamma, is less than gamma D. That is the normal case. And that's why we say that the tropical atmosphere is normally conditionally unstable. And so this is the criteria for conditional instability. That is, gamma S must be less than gamma, must be less than gamma D. This is the criteria for conditional instability. Okay. So, any question today? Till now? Is there any question? Everybody is silent.
No.
Am I audible?
No, sir.
Okay, great.
Yes, sir.
Very good.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
So, if there is no question, then we shall stop today's class. Okay. I stop sharing the PowerPoint. All right. And I see that 13 students are there. Is there anybody who missed the attendance in the beginning?
Yes, sir, me.
Devasis, okay, fine. Anybody else? No? So nobody missed the attendance and nobody has any question, right, for today?
Sir.
Yeah, Alvin.
So is it possible to get an off day on this Saturday?
Possible to what?
To get an off day on holiday this Saturday.
Get what? Holiday?
Yes, sir.
But Saturday, do you have class? Saturday is generally a holiday, no? Acha, you have classes on Saturday because of this.
Yes, sir, we have class.
Yeah, this semester because of the COVID. But I have to talk to your teachers. Saturday is what? I mean, Friday is 25th December. That is, tomorrow is a holiday, Christmas, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, but Saturday is a working day, but you have to talk to your teachers, you know, who have the classes on Saturday, okay?
Yes,
if they allow you leave, then you can have the holiday. It all depends on the teacher, okay?
Yes,
yeah, generally we used to have holidays on Saturday and Sunday, but because of this year's, you know, situation, a special situation because of the COVID, the classes, syllabus has to be completed. In time, and so we are taking extra classes on Saturday. Otherwise, Saturday used to be all day anyway. Okay, so you talk to the teacher, and then the respective teacher will tell you. Okay, so we stop the class. Okay, and I'm going to stop recording.